Reed.
Here.
And Counsel Watson.
Here.
The Pledge of Allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Hearing none, we'll move right to the fun part of the program, the presentations. Stacy Pickering. Hi. We have a few resolutions tonight, and each and every one of them are important. The first is for Stacy Pickering, Cape Elizabeth Town Council resolution. Whereas Stacy Pickering, an esteemed resident, ooh, I like that, of Cape Elizabeth and a student at Cape Elizabeth High School, has achieved national recognition for exemplary volunteer service by receiving a 1999 Prudential Spirit of the Community Award as one of the top two student volunteers in Maine. And whereas this prestigious award, presented by the Prudential Insurance Company of America in partnership with the National Association of Secondary School Principals, honors young volunteers across America who have demonstrated an extraordinary commitment to serving their communities, and whereas Ms. Pickering earned this award by giving of her time and energy to Cape Elizabeth, educating students in domestic violence prevention activities, and whereas the success of the state of Maine, the strength of our communities, and the overall vitality of American society depend in great measure upon the dedication of young people like Stacy Pickering, who use their considerable talents and resources to serve others. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in Town Council assembled, that we hereby congratulate and honor Stacy Pickering as a recipient of a Prudential Spirit of Community Award, recognizing her outstanding record of volunteer service, peer leadership, and community spirit, and we extend best wishes for her continued success and happiness. Dated this year, signed by all the members of the Town Council. Congratulations.
Thank you.
You actually get a minute.
I'd just like to say a few words. I definitely appreciate being recognized for this kind of work, but I also do have to give considerable amount of thanks and credit to all the people who work really hard over at Family Crisis Services. There are men and women who put a lot of time and effort thanklessly into teaching and educating people about domestic violence and also trying to keep people safe, so they definitely deserve a lot of credit, and I thank them for that, teaching me how to do it, so thanks.
Katie Beal. Hi.
Hi.
This is a fun job. Cape Elizabeth Town Council resolution. Whereas Catherine Beal, an esteemed resident of Cape Elizabeth and a student at Catherine McCauley High School, has achieved national recognition for exemplary volunteer service by receiving a 1999 Prudential Spirit of Community Award. And whereas this prestigious award, presented by the Prudential Insurance Company of America in partnership with the National Association of Secondary School Principals, honors young volunteers across America who have demonstrated an extraordinary commitment to serving their communities. And whereas Ms. Beal has earned this award by giving generously of her time and energy to her Key Club and to beginning a service program amongst youth at middle school. And whereas the success of the state of Maine, the strength of our communities, and the overall vitality of American society depend in great measure upon the dedication of young people like Catherine Beal, who use their considerable talents and resources to serve others. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council that we hereby congratulate and honor Catherine Beal as a recipient of a Prudential Spirit of Community Award, recognize her outstanding record of volunteer service, peer leadership, and community spirit, and extend our best wishes for her continued success and happiness, dated this year and signed by all the members of the Town Council. Congratulations.
Put this down so everybody can hear you.
I think I need to give some credit to the Holy Cross School for letting me do it and letting me come into the middle school and show them what I've learned for community service and helping them to help out their community in the ways that I've learned, and also to Catherine McCauley High School for supporting me in everything I did so that I could charter the club and help them run it successfully. So.
Thank you. Well, now we're going to take a tour of various sports in Cape Elizabeth.
Don't forget music.
Oh, we're saving one to the end. First, we have the 1998 Boys High School State Lacrosse Champions. Is Ben Raymond here? Who's here? Who's ever here? Everybody come up. Now this is, we're just getting around to last year because it's very difficult with lacrosse because by the time they win the state championship, they all just sort of go away. But we were hopeful that giving the award at this time would generate a lot of interest in this year's season because again, I think we're going to have a fine team. Town of Cape Elizabeth Town Council Proclamation, Cape Elizabeth Boys Lacrosse Main Principals Association Championship. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth Boys Lacrosse team recently, well, wasn't as recently, earned their ninth straight Main Lacrosse Championship, the first ever Principals Association sanctioned championship, and are now 9-for-9 in the 90s. And whereas winning the final game was the culmination of a season that had 15 victories and no losses, and whereas the team won the final game and a come-from-behind victory that showed the confidence the team had in their abilities, whereas the entire Cape Elizabeth community is proud of the accomplishments of the members of this team, I should note to the coach also, now therefore be it resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council that we hereby congratulate the Cape Elizabeth Boys Lacrosse State Champions, and we praise them for the honor they have earned for themselves, their families, for their school, and for their community. Signed by all the members of the Town Council. Congratulations.
Go ahead for a second.
It was a great year, and we look forward to doing it again this year. We opened it up today and won, so hopefully we can do it again.
A little out of order. The 1999 boys and girls middle school Nordic team, please come forward. Buzzy, come over here. Absolutely. Well, that's an idea. Cape Elizabeth Town Council resolution. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth Middle School Nordic Ski Team recently competed in the state middle school meet in Bethel, and whereas both the boys and girls team won all four middle school titles in the classic and freestyle events, and whereas Nordic skiing is a sport that requires individual determination, supportive coaching, and serves as an encouragement to lifelong fitness, and whereas the entire community of Cape Elizabeth is proud of the achievement of the middle school Nordic ski team, now, therefore, be it resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in Town Council assembled, does hereby congratulate the middle school Nordic ski team on their victory, and we thank them and their coaches for providing such excellent representation of Cape Elizabeth. We also express our appreciation for being such an inspiration to Nordic skiers of all ages. Signed by all the members of the Town Council. Muzzy, congratulations. Come on, your dad would come too. Here we go.
You guys want to talk?
Well, come on up anyway. Come up. Muzzy did a great job.
I just wanted to thank also two of our coaches that were unfortunately not able to be here tonight, Laura Suba and also Mike Miller, who also assisted. And not only is this a great group of skiers, but they're also a great group of citizens. Thank you.
And now we'll move on, fast forward to what happens when they get out of middle school. And would the Cape Elizabeth High School Boys Varsity Nordic Ski Team or any representative come forward? Coach Upton?
Yes.
Yeah? Well, you're the coach.
Well, we both are.
You're both the coach. That's great. Cape Elizabeth Town Council resolution. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth High School Boys Varsity Nordic Ski Team won the Class B state title in the 5-kilometer event during the recent state championship meet, and whereas the boys team won this event as a result of having 4 team members complete the course within the top 10 finishers, whereas Nordic skiing is a sport that requires individual determination, supportive coaching, and serves as an encouragement to lifelong fitness, and whereas the entire community of Cape Elizabeth is proud of the achievement of the boys varsity Nordic ski team in winning the Class B title, now therefore be it resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in Town Council assembled, does hereby congratulate the boys varsity Nordic ski team and their coaches on their victory, and we thank them and their coaches for providing such excellent representation of Cape Elizabeth. And we also express our appreciation for being such an inspiration to Nordic skiers of all ages. Signed by all the members of the Town Council. Congratulations.
I just want to say thank you for this recognition and note that this is the second year in a row. We're very proud of that. And also on behalf of the entire club of Cape Nordic, which involves the middle school team as well, I want to thank you for your continuing support of the Bottle Shed. We just had another successful month last month, and the funds we raised from the Bottle Shed will continue to support these kids and their endeavors. Thank you.
Next we have the 1999 Boys High School Ice Hockey Team. Coach Russo, who's here? Come on up. How you doing? Town of Cape Elizabeth, Cape Elizabeth Town Council Proclamation. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth Boys Ice Hockey Team earned the 1999 Class B State Championship. Whereas the championship game was a hard-fought match against an excellent team from a community with great hockey spirit. And whereas the victory resulted in the first state title for ice hockey for Cape Elizabeth in 17 years, in a sport that has become increasingly competitive statewide. Whereas this team's 17-4-2 season is the culmination of dozens of practices over many years, the devoted attention to skating techniques, offensive tactics, and defensive maneuvers, with the practices at odd hours and with the need for many sacrifices. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council that we hereby congratulate the Cape Elizabeth Boys Ice Hockey Team on the state championship, and we salute them, their coaches, their parents, and all others whose efforts helped lead to this victory. Signed by all the members of the Town Council. Congratulations. Thank you.
Uh, On behalf of the hockey team, I thank the town council and the town of Cape Elizabeth. Thank you very much.
On behalf of Sean Russo and Steve Ouellette, who couldn't make it, thank you very much. It was a great year, and hope many more.
Great. And last, but certainly not least, we have the 1999 Berklee College Jazz Fest winners, the Cape Elizabeth High School Jazz Band. See, I knew there was a reason he was the student representative. Cape Elizabeth Town Council Resolution. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth High School Jazz Band finished first in the 31st annual Berklee College High School Jazz Fest at the Heinz Auditorium in Boston, and whereas over 150 schools participated in the musical competition, including nearly 3,000 high school students, and whereas the jazz band and combo band's members, including Chris Gagne, Jeff Butterworth, Tim Butterworth, and Alan Khan, were the winners of Judges' Choice Awards for their superior musical abilities, and whereas at the conclusion of the competition, before an audience of 2,000 parents, musical fans, and judges, the Cape Elizabeth Jazz Band bested all other performers present. Now, therefore, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council and Town Council Assembled does hereby congratulate all of the participants from the Cape Elizabeth High School for their achievements in the Berklee College High School Jazz Fest, and we particularly salute those students who took the top honors at the fest, and we thank their directors and parents for the inspiration that they have provided that led to this unique accomplishment. Dated this year and signed by all the members of the Town Council. Congratulations, Vince.
Thank you. On behalf of the entire jazz band and Mr. Norm Richardson, who couldn't be here also tonight, I want to thank you for this. It means a lot. Thank you very much.
We're just going to wait for a moment to allow a clearing of the hall.
Mr. Chairman, while we're waiting for that moment, could I say that I was especially impressed with the high school jazz band the other night. I can remember in my own generation when the high school jazz band used to sound like mealtime at the zoo. And I went over, I mean, it was tuning up and just terrible. And I went over there to the high school the other night and heard that wonderful Cape Elizabeth jazz band. And Jeff Butterworth, I thought, with his trumpet, lead trumpet, was going to blow the roof off of that building. And it was wonderful. They were together. The rhythm was tight. And I spent a lot of my life in music. And I just want to congratulate Vince and all the members of the band for a wonderful job. Think of 150 bands in that Berklee. Yes. Group, all competing, and Cape Elizabeth comes in. I just think that's wonderful. And,
well, I think what's particularly wonderful tonight is when we, as the town council, can recognize activities in this community that are so diverse. I mean, not athletics and community service and music, and that's been one of the great things when I've been chair the last period of time. Is just to start to have an appreciation for how many wonderful things so many people in our community accomplish. Yeah. And it's just extraordinary. And that's one of the reasons I think that we all chose to live in this community and why this is just a great place.
They're ready for the Tonight Show.
Yeah. All right. Moving on to the exciting agenda this evening. We first have councilors' reports and correspondence. I call Councillor Watson.
Chairman Graff, I just would like to bring a couple of things before us. I serve on the Legislative Policy Committee for the town of Cape Elizabeth, and I just wanted to let everybody know that school funding is still very much up in the air in Augusta. However, the Department of Education proposal seems to be the one that's leading the pack in terms of the various plans. However, that still wouldn't see Cape Elizabeth having very much relief. We'd still see the same amount of shortfall that we're currently seeing. So that's one item. The other item is the gas tax. The gas tax is still in committee, but it appears that it's going to go before the legislature with a proposal that a 5 cents be added to the gas tax to support the highway fund. And right now they're currently looking at a 2% increase in the year 2000, a 3% increase in the year 2001. That's still being worked out, but it looks like we're probably going to be looking at a gas tax to fund highways passing in the legislature. And the other issue is the boat sales tax on docking fees. This is being proposed as a way to generate additional revenue for the state. However, I'm pleased to report that the committee has pretty much deadlocked on this, and it looks like it's probably not going to go forward. So it looks like the boat sales tax on docking fees is probably not going to be go to legislature for a vote.
Thank you.
It's stuck in committee.
Thank you. Councillor Reed.
Thank you, Chairman Graff. As the finance chair of the town council, I would like to remind the citizens that on April 14th, the town council will complete its review of the municipal budget and also a review of the school budget. We have previously met to review the municipal budget, special funds, community services, the museum at Portland Headlight, Riverside, etc., and that we will be planning on a public hearing and subsequent budget adoption on May 10th of 1999, and that all these meetings are open to the public. If citizens have comments, to please let us know. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Carson passes. Anybody over here? Councillor Berry.
Yes. Mr. Chairman, Councillor Fritz and I have served on the Historic Study Committee, attempting to work on drafting an ordinance with our committee relating to historic sites in Cape Elizabeth. We have a meeting for a public input coming up, which we're looking forward to, on April 29th. That will be at 7 p.m. It will be here right in this room. We hope to have it televised, and we invite all the people who are able to make it to this meeting to please come and share their thoughts with us, because we want your input. We want to know how the community feels about various parts of a historic preservation ordinance. This has to do with the preservation of older buildings and sites in the town, a lot of or a number of which go back into the 1700s. And there is some feeling in various areas as to how much should be preserved, and personal property rights versus the rights of the community. And we've reviewed ordinance from other communities. Portland, Kennebunk, various communities have ordinances for historical preservation. And I know the city, the old part of the city of Quebec in Canada, has very strictly enforced regulations for construction there to preserve the real old world flavor of that part of Quebec City. And many of the towns in Maine have these. I'd like to express our thanks to town planner Maureen O'Mara, who has served as the staff for our committee, because she's done a lot of work on this. There will be an article on the internet, what do they call it, the website, and the, I'm not computer literate, but there'll also be a thing in the Cape Courier, which we invite you to read, and we want you to let our committee know, either through Maureen O'Mara, the town planner, or members of our committee, what your thoughts are about such an ordinance, and what type of building should be included, so on. So we welcome. That's April 29th at 7 o'clock. The meeting will be right in this room. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Anyone else? I will remind, and the town manager will provide the specifics, but the kickoff for our Fort Williams celebration begins tomorrow. There was a wonderful article in the Portland Press Herald today. I encourage you all to find it and read it. The fort has provided inspiration to many, many people over the years. Remember, it's not too late to donate and help us as a town celebrate properly. I have signed many, many, many thank you notes for people in this community that have sent in a charitable contribution to assist. I encourage you all to think about that, and mostly I encourage all of you to read that article and circle on your calendars the various events this summer at the fort. It's just been a wonderful effort by a hardworking group of people, and now that effort is about to come to fruition. Mr. McGovern, the town manager's report.
Yeah, just to follow up on that, Mr. Groff, the open house tomorrow at Fort Williams begins with a dedication of a new entrance sign to Fort Williams that will be in place all year long. That begins at 5 o'clock. At 5:30, at what is known as the Parks Maintenance Building, which is when you go down the hill toward the lighthouse, instead of taking a left, you take a right. That is where the actual ceremony begins at 5:30. Everyone from the public is invited. I haven't been over, but I hear the building has been totally transformed. There's uniforms of all the different services. There's flags. There's blown-up photographs. For anyone who is at all interested in the military history of Fort Williams, it'll be a wonderful event to attend, and there's been the full Centennial Committee is working on it, and particularly a very, very hard-working subcommittee on this event tomorrow. And Barbara's Kitchen, some of you may know, is over, what's that intersection called? Across from DePietro's, has donated hors d'oeuvres for everyone to enjoy, so it should be a very nice occasion, and everyone is invited. Second, I want to mention something that happened in Fort Williams this past month. I happened to be out one day with Bob Malley, the Director of Public Works, and there was a call came over the radio that someone had fallen off the cliffs at Fort Williams. And we went over and discovered that there was a young man who was here with the Upward People group who had somehow gone down below the rocks and decided to try to climb back up them. And when he was about halfway up, he fell back down. And it ended up he was in an area that's probably the steepest cliff at Fort Williams. It ended up the rescue responded, the fire department responded, Public Works was there, the police department, and the WET team. And it was the most fascinating experience that I've seen of a rescue in the years that I've been in Cape Elizabeth. It ended up that they actually removed this gentleman after about 45 minutes with the ladder truck, with the ladder extended with a rope hanging down, attached the patient to a gurney. John Beyer, who's a member of the WET team, went up with him through the air a little. If any of you saw the news tonight from Atlanta, it was, you know, that on a smaller scale. But meanwhile, there are also four WET team members who were actually in the ocean. It was right after a big storm, and they were almost up to their waist in the churning ocean. And this was back, you know, the end of mid-March, late March. It was real, real cold. So I just want to say I was extremely impressed with everyone working together. Chris Carson, who happens to be the son of Councillor Carson, was the primary first responder, along with Eric Fay, who's an off-duty police officer, Kevin Guimon from the South Portland Rescue, loads of members. John was there as a member of the Cape Elizabeth Rescue, and the person who actually took the young man up was John Beyer, who ironically is the son of former Councillor Bill Beyer. So it was really a coming together of the community, and I was really proud of everything that I saw and wanted to mention it.
Thank you. You're done?
I'm done.
Is there a motion to approve the minutes of the March 10th, 1999 Town Council meeting?
Mr. Chairman, I so move.
Councilor Barry moves. Councilor Watson seconds. Discussion? Hearing none. All in favor? Carries 7-0. Do our student representatives have, what date's the high school graduation this year, May 11th? June 11th.
They wish.
I'm just pushing them out earlier.
He could change it.
All right. If you have something to say tonight, make sure you raise your hand, because I sometimes, especially Matt, hides in the corner. Matt? I'm sorry, when are the elections?
I believe
April?
The week after.
Well, this item really isn't on the agenda, but I don't think it's, I think it's more of a procedural matter than, and I'd certainly like to get the sense of the town council as to, Councilor Watson.
I would support an April vote on the part of the student council to select the representatives for next year. I think that would be timely. That means in September, before, right as school starts, they might even be able to attend the first meeting in September. So I think that it might behoove us to let them go ahead and do that.
Is there further discussion?
Just a question for Council Watson. I don't think you were intending to not invite them during the summer if they're...
Oh, no, not at all. No, but the new representatives starting in the fall. And I would hope that Matt and Vince would be able to come some in the summer, too, as their schedules would permit.
Councilor Reed.
I bet their summers are no less busy.
No, that's
their school year. But I strongly support the continuation of the student counselors, and I hope that we do approve that. The continuing effort.
Well, what I'm going to do is, because this item is not on the agenda, if there's any member of the town council that does not want to consider this, I am not going to consider it. Is there any such member?
If it would be appropriate, Mr. Chairman, I would move to suspend the rules and add an item in the agenda.
Well, we can do that, but as a matter of courtesy, I just did not want to consider this unless all the members of the town council believed it was appropriate. I clearly understand the rules, too, that we could add this, but in something like this, it's just come this quickly. I feel uncomfortable doing that.
There is a council meeting Wednesday night at the conclusion, a special council meeting at the conclusion of the Finance Committee meeting, simply to set the budget for public hearing. If the council desired, since the agenda hasn't been published yet, we could still add that to the special meeting agenda, so it would be formally voted upon.
I would feel more comfortable doing that. Is that the consensus of the town council?
Sure.
That'd be fine.
Thank you very much for bringing it up, and we'll put that on the agenda for the Wednesday meeting, which was usually is very brief because we just set a public hearing on the budget, and we can take up that item of business and discuss it at that time. All right, item 108 is consideration of a request to refer to the Planning Board proposed amendments to the Town Center provisions of the zoning ordinance. This matter was tabled from 3/10/99 to tonight, and my understanding is that the applicant is requesting that this matter again be tabled until May 10th, 1999. Is there a motion to table? Councilor Reed.
So moved.
Second.
Seconded by Councilor Berry.
May 12th.
Mine says May 10th. Should that be May 12th?
The second Monday of May.
Is that the understanding of the motion? The second Monday of May, Councilor Reed?
Yes.
All right. All in favor of the motion to table? 7-0. The motion is tabled, the item is tabled until the second Monday in May. Item number 110. This item was tabled on March 10th, 1999. Is there a motion to bring this item back on the table?
So
Councilor
moved.
Ginty.
So moved.
Moved. Councilor Fritz seconds. All in favor? 7-0. The matter is now back on the table. Madam Clerk, this is within your area of expertise. If you could tell us what's going on here.
Thank you very much. Before you, you have recommended fees for burial services at Riverside Cemetery for the 1999 and 2000 year. You will see that Jerry Murray did receive the bid. He is a low bid and will be awarded that for the next 2 years. I'd recommend that you approve the fees as recommended.
Is there a motion?
I'd move that the fees be as recommended for the years 1998, 99, and 2000.
Well, this is, we're looking at 99 and 2000.
99 and 2000, yeah, 98 not necessary.
Right. 98 won't do as much good anymore.
As recommended.
All right. Is there a second to the motion? Councilor Reed. Motion has been moved and seconded. Is there discussion? Doesn't appear this is a very controversial item. All vote, all in favor? Opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Thank you very much, Madam Clerk. Item number 116, action upon recommendation from the Community Pool Building Committee to award a bid for the reconstruction of the Donald Richards Community Pool. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, this is an item that I'd rather not be discussing to the degree that we'll be discussing tonight. However, unfortunately, I think as everyone is aware, the bids came in higher than anticipated. This came about, the actual pool project, as a result of a couple of committees' efforts over the years. First, an initial study committee, and then the actual building committee. It was a surprise that the bids came in to the degree that they did over budget, but it was no surprise that they came over budget. Particularly as we looked at the past couple of years in this project as it has evolved. When the council received a report last April from the building committee and recommended a bond issue, there was quite a bit of support for it. There was extensive discussion. But one of the issues that was in that report was the amount of contingency for the project. And regrettably, it was only 5% of the proposed construction cost. And, you know, I think we all know now that was a mistake. Generally, when you do a project, you ought to look at when you're doing it and leave an allowance for cost of living. Plus, you also need essentially two contingencies within any bid. One is a 5% bid contingency, and the second is approximately 5%, sometimes can go as high as 10%, construction contingency. So whereas, you know, we should have probably had a 15% contingency in this bid, in fact, we only had 5%. We also, if you look back at that report from April 1998, there was also nothing at all funded in that for asbestos removal, an expense that ultimately was around $21,000, nor was there any amount in the budget for the incidentals that one runs across during a project. These are such things, everything from benches to the storage of all the pool equipment during the project. There was no carrying amount for that, so that's proposed to be carried forward at a $20,000 level. The amount that the citizens approved for the pool during a bond issue at which the project was approved last November was $2.2 million. That was approved by almost exactly 75% of the voters in favor, 25% against. When we look at the pool itself and what the building committee has recommended, and Dave Sear, the chairman of the building committee, could talk about the specifics, the actual construction cost is $2,258,000. In addition to that, you need to add the $21,000 for asbestos removal, the $20,000 for the miscellaneous odds and ends. You need to have the full construction, engineering, the architect's fees, not only for up to this point, but also for overseeing the construction. That's a total of $225,000. In addition to that, we also need to have a contingency for unforeseen circumstances. That, my sense, is a little on the high side, but we're carrying $170,000. You add up, the reason I say that's a little on the high side is I don't want to be back here 6 months from now looking for more money. This is embarrassing enough. When you add up all of those expenses above the $2.2 million, it's approximately another $496,000. That is not the best position to be in at this point. However, the building committee, I won't go into too much of the details of what they recommended, because, you know, committee members can do that. But I will say, you know, what can the town do, you know, if the council's inclined to go forward with this project in terms of meeting that gap? One of the fortunate pieces of where we stand at this point that at least gives the council the flexibility to move forward is the fact that this is part of a number of other projects as well in looking at it, something that we've called the Facilities 2000 Initiative. It includes the reconstruction of the swimming pool. It includes the relocation of the public works garage from its current location across the street from the town hall off Jordan Way to the Gulf Crest property, which is the property just adjacent to the refuse disposal area. It includes the construction of some ball fields on that same site. It includes some trail work on that same site. It also includes this whole Facilities 2000 initiative, the movement of the Engine 2 fire station, which is located across from the town hall, into what is now the public works garage. And it also includes a makeover of some type of the current fire station into a police station. The plan had been to bond the pool at the $2.2 million and to fund what was referred to as soft cost, those things other than the construction cost, with some pay-as-you-go monies that have been appropriated by the town council in both this current year's budget as well as in the budget for the year beginning July 1. That fortunately had been appropriated by the town council, so it gives the flexibility that instead of using that money for the pay-as-you-go expenses, particularly for the public works project and for the public safety projects, instead we would simply take those projects and bond them in their entirety and use those pay-as-you-go funds to complete the full pool proposal as recommended by the building committee. That's where the town could conceivably come up with the money if it's the decision of the town council to go forward. What effect does that have on the overall plan? Where do we stand with taxes? You know, what is the ultimate impact on citizens? Under the proposal, the plan is to borrow the $2.2 million for the swimming pool sometime this summer. The plan has been and continues to be to borrow all of the improvements for the Gulf Crest property at the same time. That is budgeted at all the improvements of the Gulf Crest property currently at $3 million. So that would be a $5.2 million borrowing. The budget that the Finance Committee is now looking at includes an overall tax increase, including half of which, approximately a little more than half of which, is for school purposes, of 2.74%. So the budget for the next fiscal year that's being proposed contains the full funding of the swimming pool, that what will be the debt service payment, but not the full funding, because it's going to pay for it over the next 20 years, but a sufficient fund so the tax will not have to be raised again in order to fix the pool. It includes, out of what we plan to do in the Gulf Crest property, all but approximately $60,000 of annual debt service payments for that. So if we simply did nothing else beyond that, which is not proposed, we put ourselves in the hole by taking action on the pool, approximately 9 cents on next year's tax rate to do not only the pool, but to do all of the Gulf Crest property. So if everything stopped right there, we're looking at this year's budget proposed increase of 2.74%, including the school portion, plus for what you'd really be obligating yourself to this year with the Gulf Crest property, the equivalent of an additional 9 cents. It may be less than that, it may be more than that, but it should be less than that. And all of this is predicated on interest rates slightly higher than we're now paying. The public safety portion of it, The effect would be that that would be delayed for several months. We had hoped late in the upcoming fiscal year, the one that begins July 1 of 1999, to begin the design of the revised police and fire facilities. Instead, that will have to wait because there isn't this pay-as-you-go money available until after July 1. That estimate of what those public safety facilities is going to cost, I have put numbers out. The council, quite frankly, has not bought into those numbers. It's something that's still being studied by the Facilities 2000 Committee, which is a committee of citizens. Even if we took my high-end estimates, which again the council hasn't bought into, we're looking at a 1%, and including the 9 cents I just mentioned, to do all of this would increase the taxes after this year 1% in fiscal year 2001 and an additional 1% in fiscal year 2002. And from that, we would have the pool completely done, would have the new public works garage, would have the new ball fields, would have the nature trails, would have the police, the fire department moving to the public works garage, and would have something of a new police station, either in the renovated facility or new construction. And again, that hasn't been decided where the current police station is. So that's the overall picture of where we stand with financing with all these projects. I think it's important for everyone to know that. So the only reason that the council really could consider coming up with money of this sort is the fact that we plan to do those projects as pay-as-you-go, and it does have the effect of delaying other projects. Beyond that, I'll defer to the chairman and the council, the chairman of the building committee, on the particulars of what's in the pool project and what some of their decisions have been.
Thank you. I think how we're going to go is if there's a motion at this point in time, I'd rather have a motion made and seconded, then we can have discussion. I believe that would be the most appropriate way to proceed. Councilor Reed.
I'd be happy to try a motion, Mr. Chairman, that the town council authorizes the town manager to sign a contract with Wright Ryan Construction for the renovation of the community pool and related improvements in the amount of $2,257,265. $2.2 million of that amount is to be funded through the proceeds of the bond authorized by the voters of Cape Elizabeth. The balance of $57,265 in all architectural and engineering fees amounting to $225,000, asbestos removal fees amounting to $21,000, and miscellaneous expenses amounting to $20,000 is hereby funded through the $100,000 appropriation for the pool approved by the Town Council on July 13, 1998. And from the $225,050 approved for pool rehabilitation and levee purchase as part of the fiscal year 99 budget. The contingency for this project shall be $170,000, which shall be provided for in the fiscal year 2000 budget and which may not be spent prior to July 1, 1999. Underlined, all unused contingency shall remain in the Facilities 2000 account.
Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Councilor Carson. I'm trying to have discussion. What I would like to do, because I think there are probably at various times there might be people in the audience with particular expertise that councilors might wish to call upon. I'll let individual councilors do that. But I think first, before we get to a council discussion, it might be appropriate to have a general overview of what happened with the bid process by the chair of the pool committee, just so that the public and the council can perhaps get some information on, I'm sure, what is a common question for all of us. Mr. Sear.
Thank you. My name is Dave Sear. I live at 15 Macaulay Road, and as you mentioned, I've been the chair of the pool committee for about 2 years. I might mention that it was an absolute pleasure sitting in the audience listening to the awards given to the wonderful students that we have in our school system, and standing before you on this project is not one of those pleasures that I had in the
Well, we appreciate the fact that you're here anyway.
Okay, thank you. The pool committee started, and if I'm going too far back, let me know, but started back in 1997.
Let me stop a second. I want you to take your time, because this is a big, this is an important thing for this town. And I think it's not only for the town council, but all the citizens should have a clear understanding of what's happened in this pool project. So don't feel a bit bad by going back, and I'm asking you to be complete.
Okay, thank you. The pool committee was organized in 1997 to take a look at the pool facility and to develop a recommendation and proposal to send to the city council for renovating the pool. The groundwork for that committee had actually been done a year earlier in a report prepared in 1996 that outlined some of the major problems with the existing pool design. So I guess it's been recognized, and that sort of predates my involvement with the committee as well as most of the members. But basically, it was recognized that there were some serious problems with the pool, and recognized also that the pool had essentially reached its useful life. The pool, and correct me, Michael, if I'm off on some of the dates, but the pool had been in existence some 30 years, and it was simply a function of normal wear and tear accumulating all over that period of time, as well as the issues relating to the degree of maintenance on the pool facilities as far as the pool structure itself, the mechanicals, the electrical, the interior of the building. The pool committee had a mandate, and I'll refer periodically to the April 1998 report because a lot of this stuff isn't fresh in my mind. But the pool committee, the purpose of the committee, and I'll quote here, the committee purpose stated here was shall develop a specific proposal to renovate and improve the Donald Richards Pool, including any desired modifications to the pool wing of the Cape Elizabeth High School. The committee started looking first in late 1997 at a pool design that looked at the framework of the pool structure itself and trying to determine what we would do with that pool structure. We were guided in our deliberations by Harriman Associates, which is an architectural firm that was hired by the town of Cape Elizabeth for that purpose. In the course of our deliberations, we began to realize that when we were starting to address one issue, such as seating, for example, on the pool deck, then the obvious solution was to expand the facility to include separate seating. We started looking at some of the safety concerns, which led us to recommend some of the renovations to the locker room, also considering the fact that the locker rooms are in deplorable shape. The other consideration that I think drove a lot of our decisions is that it became apparent to us that the pool had a broad appeal, that it appealed to the youth of this community. It also appealed to the senior citizens of the community and everybody in between. So we considered designing a facility and recommending a facility that would address all of the needs of the community, not only for swimming, but basically to provide a facility that would allow for therapeutic uses, recreational uses, health uses, and there are just a variety of other applications that that would fit the need of the community. Having discussed all of these issues, then we concluded that the major structural changes to the pool that we saw needed, one was the pool basin itself, to simply remove the existing pool basin. The pool basin, based on what the engineering studies told us, had a remaining useful life 2 years ago of 2 to 5 years, and the engineers strongly suggested, indicated to us that the pool structure itself would potentially experience some localized collapse in a 2 to 5 year time frame. So we're essentially today in the beginning edge of that 2 to 5 year window. So it's a given that we would need to replace the pool structure, and with that, then it made sense to replace the mechanical parts of the pool. And the pool, as I mentioned before, had a useful life that was now exceeded, but also it was constructed 30 years ago state-of-the-art, and things have changed over time, as they do for everything else. The pool itself suffered corrosion caused by the sub deck air circulation system, where chlorinated air basically attacked some of the steel structure in the pool and caused it to deteriorate. So we needed to look at a new system to circulate air. We needed to look at a new system to replace the below ground mechanicals that, in our view anyway, provided some serious safety concerns. We looked also at the, as I mentioned before, the locker rooms are in deplorable shape. They have been for quite a few years, and we needed to address that. The seating I mentioned before, we wanted to have a system that took the spectators off the pool deck and placed them into separate seating that then allowed the pool deck to be free of pedestrians, and that pedestrians would not come into contact with swimmers. Pedestrians would not come into contact with the slippery floor surface, and also you wouldn't have foot traffic from the street basically dragging dirt and mud and everything else on the pool deck with kids walking around in their bare feet. Trying to run through all of the major items. The other major component of this is the weight room, which received a fair amount of debate in the committee to determine whether or not it was a needed part of the pool project, because it seemed to be outside the scope of what we were looking at. However, it became apparent to us that in trying to come up with a plan that effectively addressed all of the issues that we felt the community wanted, in terms of developing a system that really came into being because of the changes that have evolved in the use of pools over the years, and in approaching a more holistic holistic standpoint, we felt that the weight room would add a tremendous amount of value, that community services could actually operate the weight room in a way. I should back. It's more of a fitness center, weights, treadmills, that sort of thing. But it could be operated as part of the overall pool project to allow community services to provide to the citizens of Cape Elizabeth a venue for exercising, not only using the pool to do so, but also using equipment. And with it, the only alternative available to the citizens now is by traveling distances outside the immediate area. We felt quite strongly that the weight room was really paying for itself. The report showed that community services could generate about $68,000 of revenue annually simply using the pool, selling pool memberships, hosting swim meets, having parties, that sort of thing. With the addition of the weight room and selling memberships to that facility, either singly or in combination with the pool membership, we saw that the community could raise about $172,000 per year. So that's slightly more than a $100,000 swing in revenues, which we feel were calculated rather conservatively to make sure that we could come up with a fiscally responsible plan. So basically, we felt the weight room was really paying for itself. Not only that, but it was allowing community services to generate enough revenue to defray the overall cost of operating the combined pool and weight room facility. The fourth item, and there may be some things I'm overlooking here, but the fourth item was a whirlpool facility. And again, the studies have shown that does attract a lot of attention. People are interested in the whirlpool concept for medical reasons or simply for relaxation. And I think, as evidenced, a lot of the members in the committee had spent some time in the South Portland pool and found that, in fact, if any of you have been there, that they have a whirlpool that does have a tremendous amount of use. And we felt that would be a good addition to the overall complex. I think that sort of, in a general sense, takes us to the pre-bid process. We were guided by Harriman Associates in the bid process, and if there was probably a fault of the process, the committee, Harriman Associates, without placing blame, is, and Michael alluded to it earlier, is we did not, as a committee, keep track of the change in the market conditions for construction costs from the first report, where there were certain numbers quoted in 1996, and then our report numbers were somewhat refreshed in 1998, but not to the degree, perhaps, that they should have been. So when the bids came in last month, we were as surprised and as hugely disappointed as anyone in the room that the numbers were higher than what we had expected. The committee looked at cutting some stuff out. We looked at possibly rebidding the proposal, and quickly realized that none of that really made a tremendous amount of sense, and it would not be prudent under the circumstances when we went back and were guided by the principles and the fundamentals and the findings and recommendations that were contained in the 1998 report, and realized that all of that still applied today. So by trying to carve out big chunks of this stuff effectively undermined our ability to produce a product that we understand the community has indicated to us through the 3-to-1 vote that they need it, and they're willing to pay for it. So we felt that our charge was to take the bid results and try to come up with the best plan that we could, and try to come up with a fiscally responsible plan at that, realizing it was going to come in over budget. And the numbers, and I think the town manager went through and detailed those, so I won't go through them again, but I think that this package is a comprehensive one, and we're here, and there are a number of people in the audience, I think, that would speak to this pool project, hopefully in favor, but if not, that's okay too, because I think it's important to get all of the opinions out on the table. But it's a comprehensive project, and it simply isn't one where we think, anyway, we can go in and start cherry-picking some of these major items and selectively choose them, because it undermines the overall project. And I'll just give you one example. The spectator seating, if we were to eliminate the spectator seating, then it would basically place all of the fans back onto the pool deck, which then means we would spend a couple $1 million without solving some very fundamental safety and sanitation problems that we had to begin with. And not only that, but the pool deck itself is going to shrink in size by virtue of the fact that we have an access ramp now, for a handicap access ramp into the pool that wasn't there before and is using up a fair amount of floor space. Some other examples, the weight room is another one again, that's considered to be a significant revenue generator. And when you look at this thing as being a 25-year project, then and multiplying 25 times 172, or just times the differential of $100,000 a year, even on present value basis, it's more than adequately justified in the numbers that we have on the table now. There are a lot of people that are very passionate about this pool. A lot of people swim as adults. A lot of people have their kids that participate. We have a very successful swim program and have had for years. I think that as I mentioned before, senior citizens, for those of you who are there at 6 o'clock in the morning, and just for clarity, I'm not, but I understand that there are a lot of people that are, that use the pool, they'll use the weight facility. It provides another added dimension to this community that I think is vital. And I'll come back to the voters who voted 3-to-1, and we think that we had an absolutely clear mandate to deliver the product. We're hugely disappointed we couldn't do it on the money, but I think that we shouldn't hold the project hostage because we might have failed in the process. I'm probably getting more emotional than I want to, so I'll end it there.
Why don't you just stay right there in the front row and have a seat. Now, this tonight is not a public hearing. I'm sure a lot of you that have come out tonight are going to be a little disappointed in that you're not all going to get an opportunity to speak. I think it is, though, since I think it's the prerogative of the chair, to attempt to allow
some participation. And for that reason, I'm going to ask, because we have a large crowd tonight, ask those individuals who have taken time out of their lives to come here tonight because they are in favor of this pool project. If you wish to stand and give the town council a sense that you've done this, I think that would be appropriate at this time. All right, for those of you at home that can't see this, this is the vast majority of the chamber has stood. Now, thank you very much. What we're going to do, an attempt to have an orderly process, is we're going to give each town councilor an opportunity to make comments. Start at my left and go to my right. That doesn't mean that this is the only comment that you can make concerning this discussion, but I just thought it appropriate on an item like this. It's been, quite frankly, a disappointment for all of us, but every disappointment also presents opportunities. For each counselor to have an individual opportunity to explain where he or she is on this issue. So we'll start with Councilor Berry.
Well, I've given this a lot of thought since this information came to us, and of course, we thought that the engineers were in touch with the market, and what we had appropriated enough funds to complete this project, and this is sort of like dominoes when one, if the pool project cannot be done with the existing funds, we have to take funds from somewhere else, and then that gets into the projects that have been mentioned, the Gulf Crest property, the police station, the fire station, the public works, all falling as the town manager has explained. The pool must go forward. The town wanted the pool and does want the pool. We have not only the want, but the need for the pool in the town, because now it's shut down and we've got to get going here on the pool. I just wonder if it would be possible to table this matter for, and that's just a question, I'm not moving yet, and I'd like to have the sense of the other councilors as to what might be done here. If we were to table this matter for about 2 weeks, no more than that, and have a special town meeting called to review this situation after the pool committee had one more chance to go to get together with the engineers, say, come on, fellas, let's see if we can, and I know this has already been attempted, and Chairman Sear has just said this, and I think the pool committee did a wonderful job in putting together choices for the council to consider and for the town to consider. We had A, B, C, and D, and they were very well thought through, and I think that the pool committee report was an excellent one and gave us a clear picture of what the situation was at that time and as the pool committee was their report was developing. And now that we've been hit with this $500,000, or $496,000, which is almost $500,000, I wonder if it would be possible to table this for about two weeks, no more than that, because we've got to get going on construction. And if need be, the town manager's proposal will set funds in place so that the projects, all of the projects, can be completed over a period of time. But I'm wondering, in my own mind, since this is $500,000 over the budget that we originally hoped for, if it would be possible for the committee to revisit this with the engineers one more time, come back to the council and see if it isn't possible to economize some, maybe perhaps meet us halfway and say instead of the $2.2 million raise, I mean, they're looking at $500,000. Is it possible to come in with $250,000? I don't know that. I'm not an engineer. I'm not on the pool committee engineering staff, and I know that that's their that is their area of expertise, not my own. But I would feel comfortable if the council would go along with that, to give it one more try to see if we could economize on some features of the pool. Maybe not. And I'm not going to vote to hold back the pool, because the people want it and the people will have it. If it's possible they cut down the price a little bit, and I think we should try. Well, that's my position.
Now, Councilor Berry, I do, if I understand you correctly, you have not, at this point in time, made a motion to table. Is that correct?
That's correct. I have not yet. I'd like to have the sense of the other councilors.
I understand. I just ask that because of all you understand that once, if there is a motion to table on the floor, all discussion stops.
I did not
we would
do
go.
That. And that's the reason why I didn't make the motion.
I appreciate that. Okay. That's why I'm making sure that's clarified.
Right.
Councilor McGinty.
Well, I think we've painted ourselves into a corner. I think you have to support the appropriation of this money to build the pool. People want it, as we all know that, clearly by their vote. I think I would not support a motion to table. I think Dave and his committee probably, I think he laid it out. They looked at what they thought they could do. You know, they squeezed some money out of it, but not nearly $500,000. My only disappointment with this is last year I fought against the 1% tax increase for this basic pay-as-you-go theory, because what we do is we pickpocket the money from today's taxpayer. Now it's going to be $500,000 we're going to take out of today's taxes to pay for this project that's going to last over 25 years. I tried to insist that we bond the full amount for all these projects, the complete Facilities 2000 projects, so the taxpayers would pay for this over the life of the projects. Obviously, I wasn't successful last year. And for the wrong reason or a different reason, you know, now we're going to take this $500,000 from today's taxpayers. But, you know, as I said, we paint ourselves into a corner. I have to support this because, you know, the pool has to get done. I support the pool. So
thank
that's
you.
Where I stand.
Councilor Fritz.
Generally, I agree with what some of the things that have been said, that the community has obviously shown that they support the pool, and the condition of the pool is just so bad that something really has to be done. And it doesn't sound as though the pool can be divided up and part of it done this year, part of it done another year, that at least I haven't seen that possibility yet. I think what the manager has proposed, that we put off some of the design and engineering or public safety building, makes sense to push that project a bit. As far as some of the things we've done in our budget deliberations is delay the parking lot at the library, which I think saves some money that we had been planning on spending. I'd still like to have some discussions with the school board on Wednesday night on maybe some of the things that they might be able to help with in bringing this into line so we don't have to raise taxes as much in order to accomplish this project. Even if we delayed it, in looking to see construction costs go down if we got into a less robust economy, then the interest rates would go up, so I'm not sure that we would gain anything that way. I had another thing written down here, but I'm not sure what I meant by it, so I'll let that go. I do have a couple of questions, though, that I'll put in after people make their
comments. Well, go ahead.
Well, I guess I wanted to be really clear on why we set aside such a large contingency. What kinds of things do we pay for out of that? I mean, are they really unforeseen things? How often do we actually use a contingency when it is set aside on projects?
Well, let's do that one right now. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, Mrs. Fritz. We generally try to set aside a 10% contingency at the beginning of a project. This one, I think, you know, because the pool has been analyzed quite a bit, we have really have known conditions, and that's why I'm only recommending 7.5%. When we get into the structure of the pool, you know, chances are you can find things that you didn't anticipate structurally that can run into some money. Some of the site work, you start digging, you run into ledge that might not have been properly budgeted. When you dig the foundations of the expanded areas, you can run into ledge in some of those areas. A lot of it is rarely on the inside, and if you look at the way the motion is drafted, It provides that if there's any money left in that contingency, that it goes back into the facilities 2,000. The other piece, what I'm really hoping is, you know, with that $20,000 amount, that for the more optional things, you know, that I get approached for, we want some more weight equipment rather than just using the existing, that that will not come out of the contingency, that that will come out of that $20,000. So, you know, my hope is that we don't need to use that contingency. But the last thing I'd want to do is to be looking at the council again over the next year and, you know, say that we just from the point. I'm hoping it can be substantial less than that, but I can't say at this point. But it's for all those unforeseen things that you don't know about.
You indicated you had a couple questions.
Right. The other question I had is when you were talking about the projections in the out years of how much we'd have to increase taxes in order to cover this, were you including, assuming that the excise tax would go up as much as it has in the past
year? No, I was assuming that all other revenues would stay absolutely flat from where they are right now, and that, you know, and all expenditures would stay flat. My assumption is that the remainder of the budget would be funded by increasing revenues and slightly increasing expenditures. This is simply the direct effect of this project, and the others. I should mention, too, that the current budget already does include an operating subsidy for the pool that is not projected to change in future years. So this is the last hit we would take for the pool itself. We would take an additional hit beyond this.
Okay. Councilor Carson.
Thank you. I think it's important that citizens know this is not the first time we've heard of this, and this is not the extent of our discussion. We get memos from the manager keeping us updating as what's going on, so we've had an opportunity not to discuss it as a group, but to hear about it individually and make some decisions on it. I've just recently been elected to the town council, and when I ran for town council in the fall, I spent quite a bit of time with the manager and with other department heads in the community to find out all the information I could. And one of the things I did find out was that the estimated tax increase for citizens for the municipal side of the budget only would be 1% per year to do this pay-as-you-go plan. And my job is to set policy that reflects the will of the people. I think the will of the people is a policy board. The will of the people clearly is that they want this pool, and I think we should have this pool. I put my confidence in the manager's ability to take care of the financial matters as to how we'll do this. I hope that we will not have to put off. I hope the revenues will increase sufficiently. We won't have to put off these projects like a domino effect. This is a long-term plan. We didn't just sit here and say, okay, we're going to change the public works building, the police, the fire, all these things. This is a long-term plan. All those facilities were built for 25 years. Most of them have lasted longer than that. It's our job to see that we provide future generations for the next 25 years. I think the entire full plan has to go forward. I support the pool as it stands now, even with the increase in money.
Thank you. Councilor Reed.
Well, I will support my motion. When it comes time to vote, I will not support Councilor Berry's to table for the comments that have already been made. I do feel that the cost overrun is unfortunate. David, I served on that 1996 committee, and it didn't take us long to realize that many of the deficiencies that the building committee is now addressing were obvious to people who weren't experts in the field. I do think that at first we grimaced at the thought of having to send this out to the voters, and now I'm thankful that we did, because we see the level of support, and I think it is unfortunate that we have things like contingencies and a very good economy, so that trying to get workers might be a little more expensive than otherwise. So it's kind of a double-edged sword. But I think it's important that we go forward. I don't think we should wait even 2 weeks, and I think as soon as Councilor Watson and Mr. Groff respond, then we'll move the question.
Councilor Watson.
Many months ago, when I received the pool committee's report on and recommendations on the pool, I thought they had done an outstanding job. I still think that you did an outstanding job on that report. Where we are today is very unfortunate. I would have hoped that our architectural consulting company would have guided us a little better. I think that it's unacceptable that a month after we go to referendum, that the pool committee is notified that there's been a 10% increase in construction costs. I hope that in the future, when we're looking at companies, we keep that in mind. The pool, we need to support it. 3-1, we have a mandate that says, you know, we want this pool, we need it. If you look at how you can make cuts in this budget, we could ask the pool committee to go with a concrete floor versus tile. I have been advised by our future pool director that there are cleaning issues and problems with a concrete floor, as well as if you're spending $2.7 million on a pool, you know, you want something that is aesthetically pleasing. I don't think concrete's going to quite get us there. We could eliminate the whirlpool, but as Chairman Sierra mentioned, 75% of the people in South Portland who go to that pool use the whirlpool. I think that if we're hoping that this project's going to generate some revenue, that we need to have the kind of amenities there that are going to attract people to come in and purchase memberships and to use the pool. I, like everybody else, am very disappointed with where we are at this project. If I thought there were another way to go, I would certainly be proposing that. You know, I've considered where Henry Berry is right now about the possibility of tabling this, going back to the table and seeing if we can save any more money. But the reality is, I think that we've squeezed it as much as we can with the current situation, and I think we've got to move forward. Time is of the essence. The pool is closed. We want to have it up and running by the fall to have our swim teams practicing and for use in our community. We're going to fund this money. We're going to pay for it anyway, so we better start having an opportunity to generate some revenue. So that's where I am on this. I wish it were different. It's not. So I will vote to move forward. But I also will be watching very carefully these projects as we come forward on Gold Crest, the renovation of public works for the fire department and the police department, and making sure that we are getting the best we can for the least amount of money on those projects.
Thank you. I'll hear from one of our student representatives. You two can decide which one.
I would agree with what all of the councilors are saying, and then you go forward. And like also, that it's unfortunate that the more costs are going to be involved. I was speaking with Matt, just to reiterate what Matt had, I think I brought up earlier, that there was a slight student concern that the weight room situation would change, and that when students can use a weight room now, it's just part of like the athletic facilities that students were open to, that the students were expressed concern to the student council that they would have to buy membership not to use the same way for service. I know Matt has brought that up, but that's still something that the students were concerned about. But,
thank you. I guess the chair gets to go last. This is one of the few real disappointments that I've had in my 3 years as a town councilor. I was very supportive of the program that we had fashioned collectively together, where we could keep all these projects going in a way where we were funding the soft cost. Little did I know that all that careful work to be able to visualize everything being completed in an orderly fashion would be upset and effectively destroyed by the failure to understand what the cost of this pool would be. Now, saying that, it's unfortunate, but life presents problems and then life presents opportunities. It won't be my opportunity to carefully review and study the additional projects that need to be completed. It's going to make that task more onerous for the town council left here and those elected, but our town has had many difficult projects that we've faced over the years. And I have an incredible amount of confidence in our town manager, in our department heads, and in our elected officials to provide solutions to these challenges that are going to come in the next couple of years. It would be entirely inappropriate. I have my ideas of how they could be met, but it would be entirely inappropriate for me to express those ideas at a meeting such as this. Needless to say, though, it's just going to make everybody's job more difficult. I'm not happy about what happened, but I understand it. Also, I think it's important for everybody in this community, including the students, to understand that there's just no free lunch. Senior citizens right now swim free in our pool. They will no longer swim free. The memberships, it will cost everybody that uses our pool more to use the new pool than it cost you to use the old pool. And you know what? That's fair. You can't vote for something and want something and say you want something and also not put your dollars where your mouth is. And this extra $500,000 is going to make that need for you to put your dollars where your mouth is more compelling than ever. I'm going to vote for the pool. I don't think there's any choice. As a wise, prudent measure, it would be absolutely silly to go back and attempt to, with the pool now closed, attempt to hope and pray that somehow construction prices are going to come down, which I don't think they are, or interest rates are going to come down, which I don't think they are, or that we can miraculously discount all the work everybody's done and find some silver bullet that's going to make everything okay. That's just not going to happen. This is the reality, and that we need to go forward. But this is going to have an impact on what future councils are able to do. It's going to be interesting. I'm going to watch with great interest, as most of you are going to watch with great interest, how our elected officials handle the issues coming up in the next couple of years. But I am confident that they will handle them well. Is there a sense that we can call the issue at this time? We're going to have a roll call vote. Madam Clerk?
Council Berry?
Yes.
Council Carson?
Yes.
Council Fritz?
Yes.
Council McGinty?
Yes.
Council Reed?
Yes.
Council Watson?
Yes.
Chairman Groff?
Yes. Motion carries 7-0. And I wish to close this pool item by again expressing my heartfelt thanks to each and every member of the pool committee and Chairman Sear. It was a job well done. Obviously, it didn't come out exactly perfect like we all would want, but that doesn't negate all the hard work that you did. Again, the reason many of us love living in this community so much is because so many people give so much of themselves for the common good, and this pool committee is a wonderful example of that. And thank you on behalf of each and every member of the town council. Item 117. And before we get to item 117, I'm sure there's a few. I see some children in the audience. I'm going to give everybody an opportunity to vacate if they wish.
You want to take a break?
Just 2 minutes. We're going to break 2 minutes.
Great.
Thank you.
first one caught him. I just don't know.
Town council meeting will continue. For those of you who on at home who took a break, this is still April 12th, and it's still regular meeting 13 of the 98-99 year. We have concluded the item on the pool, and now we are moving to item 117, action upon proposed creation of the Fort Williams Park Charitable Foundation Study Committee. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, this came about as a result of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission study of possible revenue sources for Fort Williams Park. They recommended that a charitable foundation be established. What this proposed committee would do would not be the committee that would run the foundation. It would simply be the one that would look at the true feasibility of it. They would prepare draft articles of incorporation for a 501c3 nonprofit corporation. That also make recommendations upon appropriate ways to raise money to fund the foundation, and they would make a recommendation upon the limited funds that are in the current Fort Williams Park Trust and whether or not those ought to be transferred. It'd be a 9-member committee, including a member of the town council, a member of the Fort committee, seven other members chosen through the town council appointments committee. This was a draft that was shared with the town council back in mid-March, and it was based on your discussion at a workshop with the Fort Williams Advisory Commission.
Is there a motion?
I so move. I mean, I move that the draft of the...
I thought you were just moving.
I'm trying to move right along, Mr. Chairman. I would move that the committee charge draft prepared by the town manager under item 17 be approved as read.
Is there a second?
Second.
Councilor Reed.
Also, could I ask that there be immediate advertisement for the positions upon approval?
We'll put it on the web page within the next 48 hours, but you know the courier doesn't come out for a while, but we'll work through that.
Well, the courier's present.
just so, I'm sorry.
I had a question about the 501c3 application. Does the town attorney make such an application, and then what's the process?
Well, I think my understanding of this process is that this committee can certainly utilize through the town manager, but only through the town manager, any legal resources paid for by the town. It would be my understanding that at the completion of this study committee's work, there would be, if they deemed it appropriate,
a 501(c)(3) application prepared, and that the town council members could then view. But again, I would, as with all these study committees, any expenditures, especially for legal services, goes through the town manager.
One step at a time.
Also answer Councilor Berry's question. I'm not sure if the town attorney has any expert on setting up a 501(c)(3), so we may consult with other council.
Now, I will say that because my term on the town council is going to end, my last meeting is May, I am not going to appoint the person from the town council to serve on this committee, because I think that very well might be something that, and I'm going to let that go until your first meeting as a new town council. I don't think that's going to impact on the work at all, but I think it's important that the new council chair have that ability to make that appointment. Any other discussion on this item?
Move the question.
Question's moved. All in favor? Opposed? It passes 7-0. Item number 118, consideration of a report from the Ordinance Committee recommending technical amendments to the zoning ordinance and updates of the construction codes, including the building code, the floodplain ordinance, the housing code, and the fire protection code. The Ordinance Committee is recommending this item be referred to the Town Council workshop prior to a public hearing being scheduled. Mr. McGovern.
This came from the Ordinance Committee, chaired by Councilor John McGinty.
Mr. McGinty.
Well, I'm very disappointed that people didn't stick around to go through the technical, go through the technical amendments. Most of them are just reconciliations wherein different portions of the ordinance said one thing and it wasn't reconciled in another part. It was incorrect. So that's the majority of this. We did have a couple of meetings on this. The two most controversial issues were allowing home businesses and home occupations in an accessory structure, and the establishment of lot width requirements. Those are the two major issues we thought should go to a workshop so we could discuss them. They're somewhat complicated. We actually had to have the town planner actually draw us a picture, if you will, of what some of the stuff meant. And so my recommendation, the recommendation of the committee, is that this be sent to a workshop so that we can have a informal discussion regarding it.
Well, maybe we can do it in two steps. The first step would simply be to receive the report. And do you make such a motion?
Yeah.
Sure. Second is moved to second. Receive the report. All in favor? 7-0. Now the Ordinance Committee has recommended that this be set for a workshop. Councilor McGinty, do you have a time frame in mind, or when would you like to see this workshop?
These are all, as I said, mostly technical issues.
May 17th.
Yeah.
Would May 17th be appropriate?
That would be fine.
All right. Mr. McGinty, Councilor McGinty, you would move then to set this workshop on May 17th?
So moved.
Seconded. All in favor?
7:30.
Just on that particular workshop, it'll be after the council election, and we'll invite any elected council member to participate, but not as a voting. There's no voting that occurs in the workshop.
And then it would be my understanding, our typical procedure, that if in fact the workshop concluded with general agreement, it is certainly very possible that these technical amendments would be on the June Town Council meeting agenda. Is that correct, Mr. McGovern?
That's right.
What hearing?
No, except for public hearing.
Item 119, action to authorize the town manager to execute a quit claim deed to Ronnie Halfacre for the town's interest in the condominium at 91 Starboard Drive. Mr. McGovern.
Town clerk Deborah Lane will handle this.
The town clerk.
Once again, thank you.
Oh, there we go.
On January 12, 1998, the town foreclosed on property at 91 Starboard Drive for an unpaid real estate tax lien. Since the property was not owner-occupied, we did perfect the title and took possession. I did receive from the former owner, Mrs. Ronnie Halfiger, a check in excess of $15,000. This check represents past due real estate taxes, interest and fees, condo fees and insurance, and legal fees. So this evening, we bring before you a recommendation to sign a quick claim, to authorize the manager to sign a quick claim deed back to Mrs. Halfiger. If you'll note on your council packet, the second paragraph, Mrs. Halfiger is asking the town council that we refund back to her $4,500. What this amount represents is $750 per month for rent that the town has collected since we took possession. That goes back to November through April. And again, that is a total of $4,500 on that. The memo that you have, the manager has taken no position on whether or not this money should be returned. But that is something that Mrs. Halfiger asked that the council consider this evening as well.
Is there a motion? No, where? Do you have a motion?
Yes.
Okay.
I would move that the manager be authorized to execute a quitclaim deed to Ronnie Halfiger for the town's interest in condominium formerly owned by her at 91 Starboard Drive, period.
Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Councilor McGinty. Discussion. Now, all that is on the table right now is not the request, just so we're clear, is not the request for a refund of $4,500. The only thing on the table right now is to accept this money, which I believe is in full payment of everything, correct?
That's correct.
And allow the town manager to sign a quitclaim deed. Discussion on the pending motion.
Mr. Chairman, if I might, I'd like to suggest that we did receive this money on March 31st, and we did collect the April rent. You know, in typical any real estate transaction, at the time of a closing, you prorate any income, you know, for the final month. So I'd like to suggest that the rent for the month of April be refunded to Mrs. Halfiger's in keeping with normal real estate practices.
But that's not part of this motion.
No, it's not.
Chair rules that discussion out of order.
Thank you.
Further discussion on this motion? Hearing none, all in favor? 7-0. Is there any subsequent motions on this matter? Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, I'll move the proration of the refund of the April 1999 rent to Mrs. Halfiger, as described by the town manager, as being rent after all monies were received. So that would be for the month of April only.
Second. Second by Councilor Watson. Discussion on the pending motion. Councilor Fritz.
Did we have any expenses associated with receiving that rent?
The April rent.
Any of the rent?
Well, right now we're talking about the April rent.
All right, the April rent then.
Mr. McGovern?
No, it's, you know, there's obviously, you know, a couple minutes of staff time. There's, you know, the banking fees, you know, they might charge a deposit of 15 cents, you know, that type of thing for each deposit, but that would be it.
I mean, have we had this sort of thing happen in the past where we kept the rent, even if the taxes and all the costs have been collected?
This is the first time, to my knowledge, that we've actually taken possession of a property and collected rent. This was unusual compared to most properties because it was not owner-occupied. Most of the foreclosures that we've had in the past have always been either owner-occupied or they've been vacant lots or they have been businesses where we have not dealt with the rent question because there wasn't any rent to our knowledge.
Further discussion? Hearing none, the chair has one comment, and that is that I have no problem with returning the April rent after the check was given, because in my mind, even though legal title hadn't passed, there certainly was a claim on the equitable title at that point in time when, in fact, the person that was in arrears made full payment. I will not support any further return of any rent because I think it sets a bad policy precedent
I think people have to understand, especially with commercial properties, that if they don't pay their taxes, the town has an absolute obligation to go forward and attempt to mitigate the damages. And I commend the town manager and the staff for looking at the town's interest. That is for the town to do. I do not believe that that gives a claim of any kind to the person that owned the property. So for that reason, I will support the current pending motion to return the monies that were collected after the check was presented, but that is the extent to which I will support a return of monies. Further discussion on this matter?
Has the check been honored and cleared?
No, we do not. No, the reason, Councilor Berry, our attorneys advised us many years ago that if we deposit a check that someone receives in a quitclaim, that's a de facto acceptance, and it leaves the council absolutely no authority to say no. That's the upon legal advice. We do require any check that we receive, though, to be certified.
What is this?
And or a bank check, yes.
Okay.
We do require that.
Just want to make sure the town doesn't get stuck with
further discussion. All in favor of the pending motion? Opposed? 7-0. Is there any other motion that any member of the town council wishes to make in connection with this matter? Hearing none, this matter is concluded. Item 120, approval of the warrant for the May Town Council and School Board election. Madam Clerk.
Thank you very much. This is simply calling for the Town Council and School Board election to be held on Tuesday, May 4th at the high school gymnasium. Polls are open from 7 a.m. until 8 p.m. Anyone that will not be present and would like to vote an absentee ballot, they are now available in my office. And I would recommend that you authorize the signing of the warrant.
Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Moved by Councilor McGinty, seconded by Councilor Berry. Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? Carries 7-0. Item 121, consideration of recommending to the Maine Department of Transportation proposed new speed limits for Route 77 in the town center, which would change the speed limit from the Cape Elizabeth High School driveway to Hillway from 35 miles per hour to 25 miles per hour, and from Hillway to Hunts Club Woods Road from 45 miles per hour to 35 miles per hour, as recommended by the Chief of Police in February 1996, in conjunction with the Town Council's decision to move forward with an application to improve sidewalks and pedestrian safety. Mr. McGovern.
First of all, I want to explain a little bit of the evolution of this item. It actually came in the report of the Town Center Committee in August of 1993. And what they recommended was to petition the Maine Department of Transportation to reduce the speed limit along Route 77. This should be done once the concept determining the character of the road has been adopted, such as reduced building setbacks, extended sidewalks, and possible on-street parking. Back in 1996, the Town Council, I'm not sure how many here were actually on it then, but we had a lengthy discussion one evening at which point the Town Council was reviewing the plans for the Town Center sidewalk project, and it involved the turning radius at Scott Dyer Road, particularly by the Balfour Real Estate Office, and there was a choice of, in essence, taking that whole property by eminent domain or de facto doing it by needing to take so much of it, by having a proper turning radius that the state would allow in a 35-mile-per-hour zone, or agreeing at that point in time and saying to the state that the council would petition MDOT to reduce it to 25 miles per hour. The chief had a discussion with Maureen O'Meara, the town planner. Following that town council discussion, he, at that point in time, put forward this recommendation in writing. It's actually been sitting in what we call the council pending folder in my office, which we look at every month. Every month since then, I've looked at this piece of paper. But my sense was that it was probably not something that had a whole lot of enthusiastic support of reducing the speed limit to 25 miles per hour. However, that requirement did remain there, and at some point in time, there was a possibility that the Town Center project might go forward. Well, this afternoon, at about 20 minutes of 1, I signed the contract with the contractor to move forward with that project. So it now is timely for the town council to consider the February 96 recommendation. I also want to thank Chief Pickering for being here this evening. He was here about 2 hours ago with his daughter when she was recognized for her award, and the chief and his daughter waited very patiently, and he's still here to answer any questions that you may have. Appreciate him staying.
Before we have a motion on this item, I would ask if any members of the town council wish to hear from the chief or wish to make any more general comment. Councilor Carson.
Is Lou on? Maybe I could just try to direct the chief.
Sure, Chief, why don't you come on up? People at home love to see you anyway, you know? Looks sharp.
I was just making some notes here, and I was counting up the speed limits. Is this a little unusual to have 5 speed limit changes in however many spaces that is, mile and a half?
Yes. I want to thank the manager for refreshing my memory. I couldn't remember exactly my motives for writing this memo over 3 years ago now, but they were actually twofold. One was to respond to the requirement by MDOT on the radius that turns at Scott Dyer and Shore Road, and the other was to make some kind of a predictable reduction in speed rather than have a 50-mile-an-hour zone on one end and a 45 on the other and then dropping to 25. That looked to me specifically to be an inherent speed trap where someone would drop that much of a significant reduction in speed. So we wanted some way to predictably reduce that speed limit to the epicenter, so to speak, of the town center where the improvements were going to be made. So that's why we did have 5 changes within a 2-mile stretch of road. Either that or we'd be dropping 25 miles an hour on one end, which would be significant.
Councilor Berry.
Chief, if you think 25 miles an hour is really realistic thinking, coming up this stretch of road here, it's rare, I think, to see a car or vehicle go by at that speed. And talk about speed trap, I think that you could sit out there and just bag people all day long at that speed.
Well, no, so that's why it's on the Internet, so then people know that.
Set up that speed trap on the Internet.
It's on the Internet, oh yeah.
So all certainly the Californians coming through will know ahead of time. Why could we not leave it at least at 30?
Well, quite honestly, we resisted lowering the speed limit that much, but again, we were motivated by MDOT in consideration of these improvements that are pending to come down to 25 miles an hour. I would have no objection to leaving it 30. But I don't think that would satisfy the requirements by the Maine Department of Transportation.
Well, when you say requirements, is this cast in stone by them? I mean, must we follow their suggestion?
The manager would probably address that better than I could.
Yeah. You know, just like the council has changed since 1996, in terms of the folks at the table, I'm sure we're not dealing with all the same folks at MDOT. So, you know, I can't say that they wouldn't consider 30 miles an hour instead of 25. So I don't certainly if that was the council desired petition for 30, we could discuss that with them.
Yeah. But have you had that many accidents where 50 coming up the so-called strip as far as Fowler Road and then 35 from there through the center of town, do you think it has caused a lot of accidents?
The majority of accidents have not been speed related. It's been inattention to either road conditions or driver inattention, period. Turning movements and things like that here at the intersection.
Yep. Chief, if I understand the box we're in, is that you felt your discretion in this matter was somewhat curtailed by former town council's actions where they did not take by eminent domain the Balfour property and allowed the town center to remain as it was, and part of the consequences of that at the time was MDOT saying, if you want to do that and it affects the turning radius, that you need to lower the speed limit to 25. So you're not saying you bought into that, you were made come up with that policy, you were just attempting to implement in a constructive way the decisions that had been made by some others at the time. Is that right?
That's correct. I think the initial phases of the town center concept suggested there's going to be a lot more pedestrian traffic in the center of town, which would probably necessitate a lower speed limit. So both of those things combined resulted in that decision.
So if, in fact, there was a change philosophically at this point in time, I take it without getting MDOT, engaging in a conversation again with MDOT, which in all probability would be through the town manager, you still feel pretty constrained to do the 25 miles an hour. But if the town manager met with MDOT and we reopened discussions, then that wouldn't personally offend you.
No, I'd certainly support that.
I understand. Further discussion? Councilor Reed.
Well, being the only town councilor that was then on the town center committee and was part of that discussion, Michael, I also drive this route every day, and I am concerned about the changes. And with no disrespect, Chief, there are some people in town, including myself, who aren't quite sure if the speed limit changes when you see the sign or when the rear of your car or the front of your car passes the sign. And since we are in close proximity to the high school parking lot, I would be concerned about those changes. And I'm aware of why the need for the slowing down and the turning of the corner, and I was one of those people who said we ought to square off that intersection and do it right, but I was in the minority then. But I am concerned about all the shifts and thought not to that I know how to do this perfectly, but it just seems like you can miss that 25 and be back to 35, and you might have gotten a ticket on the way, and I'm concerned about that.
Councilor Watson.
I do have concerns about the change of speed in this 2 mile radius, and I would like to propose that we go back to MDOT, find out exactly what their current requirements are, and that we table this until such time as we have additional information to make a better decision.
All right, there's been a motion to table this item. It's been seconded until such time as, I assume, you're implicit in your motion is the town manager confers with MDOT, and the town manager is in a position to forward to the town council MDOT's current thinking and position on this issue. Is that?
That's exactly what I wanted to say.
That's right. I'm sorry, there's no further discussion at this point. There's been a motion to table. All in favor? 7-0. Motion's tabled.
Put it back in the file, Mike.
No, I think, you know, we are under an obligation under the grant, so the chief and I will be meeting jointly, and that probably include Maureen O'Meara, the town planner as well, who's been the day-to-day person on this project, to meet with whoever it is at MDOT now. Hmm? I think it was, David, but this probably might involve a trip to Augusta.
But we all know that the town manager usurps resources from wherever he can. Yes, Councilor.
Mr. Chairman, may I just correct the name of one of the roads that is in that tabled motion?
Sure.
It should be Hunt Club Road.
No S on the club, huh?
No S on the club and no Woods.
All right. Item 122, action to establish an account at Lake Mason Wood Walker, say that fast, to accept a donation for the Fort Williams Centennial and any other future security transfers to the town of Cape Elizabeth, and to authorize the town manager to sell all donated securities received by Lake Mason Wood Walker. I should point out that I think initially this motion just was going to concern the Fort Williams Centennial, but I was concerned in discussing this issue with the town manager that we should have a policy in place whereby when we receive any securities, we know the town manager knows where they're going. And as a matter of policy, with any charitable gift of securities, and people do it that way, not the money, so that they can get a big, you know, where our tax system is structured, if you give the security, then you can get the entire stepped up basis and get the entire deduction. Well, if you sell it first, then you're subject to capital gain and reduces people's incentive to give. But it should be, in my view, and the reason this motion has been changed, a policy of the town council and this town that when we receive securities, they are automatically and immediately immediately is a strong word, but as quickly as possible liquidated, because we shouldn't be in the business of playing the market. We should be getting securities and then liquidating them. And that's the reason this motion was a little broader than I think perhaps originally envisioned. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second? It's been moved by Councilor Barry, seconded by Councilor Reed. Further discussion, Mr. McGovern?
No.
Anyone else? No. All in favor? 7-0, it passes. Citizens discussion of items not on the agenda. There is no such discussion. Oh, you a citizen?
Yes, okay. I am almost, again. I just wanted to remind people about candidates night for the town council and the school board candidates, and I believe that's Wednesday, the 20-something. Eighth. There you go, the candidates now.
Wednesday, the 28th?
7:30.
I'll second.
7-9.
7-9, it's League of Women Voters. It's running it again. It's an excellent opportunity to come and attend in person so that you can have your questions answered. And it's also, if you can't come in person, I'm sure it's televised many times during the month, and it's